Welcome to PJ's Worship, a virtual worship experience brought to you by the First Congregational Church of Dudley, Massachusetts, a United Church of Christ church.
Well, good morning once again. I'm the Reverend John White. I remain the extraordinarily blessed pastor of this First Congregational Church of Dudley, United Church of Christ. Folks call me Pastor John, and I sure hope that you will too. Welcome to worship for this ninth day of October, the 18th Sunday after Pentecost, this week titled Peace, Where We Are. And for more, I invite you to see our weekly e-newsletter, PJ's Place, sent October the 7th, just a couple of days ago, and PJ's podcast, which will be coming out in just a few days, Wednesday morning, as it always does, this Wednesday, October the 12th at 7 a.m., and this week titled Home, Where We Are. I want to thank you for joining us, those gathered here in our sanctuary. Our numbers still good and increasingly so, maybe a little less this holiday weekend, but so great to have you all here, and to those joining on YouTube now from home, from assisted living communities. I know there's about 20 people gathered in a particular room over there at Life Care, and perhaps someone in the hospital today. We know that Bill and family have been joining us from Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston, as I just shared with our church family here gathered in this sanctuary. Sadly, Bill did pass from this side of life to the next this morning at about 3 a.m. So thank you for gathering here in our sanctuary in a short while. Part of our joy and worship here, I will be passing plates to our ushers who will pass them to you. We will accept a financial collection at this time. No money comes to us from anywhere else. We're 100% self-supporting here. Everything from salaries to these lights to the heat that I believe is now on this morning. And thank you who join us on YouTube for continuing to send in your financial contributions to First Congregational Church of Dudley, 135 Center Road, Dudley, Massachusetts, 01571. Continue to check out all the websites, the wider United Church of Christ at ucc.org, the Southern New England Conference at sneucc.org, and our local church at ucc.dudley.org, where you'll learn so much about the very vibrant life of this particular church family. Not only am I blessed, but we are blessed. Most importantly, now and always, remember and never forget, no matter who you are, and no matter where you are, along this journey of your life, you are so deeply welcome here. Welcome. Welcome now. Kristen, thank you. And as Kristen is playing, and I'm thinking about Bill, and I'm noticing these flowers here. For anyone who doesn't know, this silk bouquet of sunflowers, this piece of folk art with the Ukrainian flag, has been there week after week, and will continue to be there as long as that feels right and necessary. And these beautiful sunflowers here also today, continuing to be here, celebrating the life of Sean, Clara and Cody's dad, who sadly passed about a year ago. Sunflowers, a favorite flower. So much today in our minds, in our hearts, as we consider in various ways this morning those times in our lives where we have been in a place where we didn't want to be, and yet from where we are, we know that better days lie ahead. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. There's God for the beauty of sunflowers. We give great thanks this day for the beauty of all of us gathering together in this way this morning. We are so grateful, dearest God, for the beauty of every small little moment of joy that will touch us today, despite the sadness of this day. We are so grateful, dearest God, for every way in which moving through this day will inspire us to know that you are with us, dearest God, through every moment of every day. We give great thanks for this time of worship now. We ask that you would center us, our minds, our hearts, our spirits. And beginning now, as together we pray, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us away from temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For those who are physically able and comfortably able to do so, let's stand and sing together. If standing is not comfortable, sitting is fine. But let's sing together number 44 in this New Century hymn book, Beautiful Jesus, number 44.
Thank you.
Would you please have a seat? Except for children, who I'm going to invite forward at this time, and I see some faces I haven't seen in a while, and that makes me happy. Well, woohoo, there's one of them. There's another one. Hey, Matt, good to see you. There's a face I see every day, and good to see that face as well. Oh, they're wonderful faces. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Cody and Theo and Joey and Adele and Oliver. So good to have all of you here. You know, we have 3 weeks of puppet stories in a row here. We have Valerie coming to visit this morning. Next week is King Sunday, and King Sunday has a new robe made, and we have invited the royal tailors to come by and visit next week. We're actually going to recognize them for their service to the kingdom. And then 2 Sundays from now, Pirate Jack is coming back for a visit. But in just a short while, I'm going to sit and talk with our puppet friend, Valerie. I've asked her to come by this morning because she really understands what we're talking about today. And when Valerie comes out, I'm going to invite you, Theo and Joey and Adele, to come and sit down here on the floor at that time. Sit here with me right now because it's kind of cool. But in just a little while, I'll invite you to come down here. There's a book in the Bible that you might not know. Our Wednesday morning Bible study group is reading it right now. There's a book in the Bible called Jeremiah, and Jeremiah has a tough job. Talking to people who might have had to move their home. Have any of you ever moved from one place to another? Yeah, me too.
Long time ago.
Yeah, a long time ago for me too now, and I never could say that till I moved here.
But on the bright side, I'm the class clown now.
Okay, all right. Yeah, moving from one place to another can be difficult. And Valerie's also here because, Jeremiah also talks to people going through other tough times, like feeling sad when someone you love has died. And Valerie's family has gone through all of that. So I'm glad that you are here to listen to her with me now. So if you'd be so kind, I'm going to invite you to come down here a little bit so you can see well. And oh, she's already there. Give me just a minute to move up there where you are, Valerie. Give me just a minute here. Give me just a minute, Valerie. Give me just a minute, Valerie.
Good morning, Pastor John.
Yep. Good morning. Give me just a minute to get up here, Valerie.
Take your time, Pastor John. Moving is difficult, especially when you've been someplace a very long time. You've been here 25 years now, and you're not as young as you used to be. That makes it even harder for you to move.
Huh? I think she's the class clown too. Maybe.
He's not taking over my school.
Anyway, well, okay, I can take a joke, Valerie. I can take a joke. But your family's moved its home before, hasn't it?
Yes, and a long way. My family lived in India for generations, yet then my grandparents moved to California. And now I've moved out of here, and those moves can be good, yet it can be difficult too.
Wow, how can something be difficult and good?
Well, when you move your home from one place to another place, you are changing everything you're used to. I mean, you might still be able to have the same toys in your room, yet when they're in a different room, in a different town, it's just not the same.
Oh, that's true. That's true. And you'd have to make a whole new group of friends, wouldn't you?
Absolutely. When my grandparents moved to this country, they didn't know anyone at first. They could still make phone calls and send letters back to India, yet it wasn't the same as having their friends there with them.
Valerie, I know that your family is part of the Sikh religion, and your beliefs are a little different than those of us gathering here in the Christian religion, yet your family and our families all believe in doing what we can to become closer to God, who wants us to work for love and justice for everyone.
Yes, Pastor John. My Sikh family spends all their life doing what they can to be closer to God by loving other people and helping them when they're hurting or in need or...
Just like Jesus wants us to do.
Yes. We believe people get closer to God even after they die. Yet, that's a little sad for me to think about.
Oh, I remember when you came by one other time. Your grandfather died, didn't he?
It was such a sad day when we moved them living with my family here as being closer to God.
His body died, but his spirit, that part of him which is most him, moved on.
That's right. But he's always with me in my heart. I feel him with me every day.
You know, I've moved lots of times too, Valerie. Moving isn't fun. And people I love have moved from this side of life to the next to be closer to God. And that's not fun either. But it's good to know that no matter where we move, God is always with us, loving us, helping us find peace and home.
Does your Bible say anything about that? About seeking peace and home where you are, even when you are, isn't some place you really want to be?
It does, Valerie. It does. A long time ago, this guy named Jeremiah, not a bullfrog. Jeremiah. He was sent by God to tell people who didn't want to move that they would have to move. And it might be a little scary, and they might not like it at first. Yet God would be with them. And so he tried to make them brave so they'd make new friends and find new peace and a new home right where they were.
What did God tell Jeremiah to say?
Well, Jeremiah said that God said, build homes, plant gardens, make families, live in peace in your new home, and God would always be with them.
So when a friend moves to a new home, or when a friend's body dies and their spirit moves closer to God, we might be sad, but we don't have to be afraid. And our friends will still be our friends, and we'll still be able to talk to them on the phone or by writing a letter if they moved homes, or by talking with them in our hearts if their body died and their spirit moved closer to God.
Yeah. I'm glad you came by today, Valerie.
Me too. If I remember, this is where we pray, right?
Oh, yeah. Valerie and children and everyone else, if you would repeat after me. God, when we move from one home to another, that's hard. And when someone's body dies, and we love that person, and their spirit moves to be closer to God's spirit. That's hard.
So help us make peace.
Within ourselves. And within our home.
Wherever we are.
Right now. Amen.
Amen.
Have a wonderful morning down in Sunday school, and come back next week. King Sunday will be here. All right.
Good to have you with us, Joe.
For anyone who doesn't know, our choir was, more than any place else, Bill's family within the larger family of our church.
Yeah.
Good morning. Last Sunday, Rick Hilliard, Bob Kersting, Amy Leary, Pastor John, and I traveled to the Congregational Church of Littleton for the annual meeting of the Central Massachusetts Association of the Southern New England Conference of the United Church of Christ. We heard a financial report from Central Association Treasurer, Dr. Bob Kersting. Remarks from Reverend Liz Garrigan-Byerly, our current area conference minister, who will be preaching here on October 23rd. And a keynote address from Executive Conference Minister Reverend Darrell Goodwin, urging us to be relevant. Transformative and transformed, and prophetic. 1 week prior, Bob Kersting, Judy Maruka, and Pastor John attended a justice summit of the Southern New England Conference at First Church of Christ in Glastonbury, Connecticut. At each event, the messages were clear. God calls us to live relevant lives with prophetic vision for justice, transforming the world as we are transformed from within. Imagine being under the domination of another nation. Imagine being born into exile. Imagine walking daily through the valley of the shadow of death, literally. Imagine home being anywhere other than where you want it to be, and believing God is asking you to seek peace and a sense of home in that place. Now you're getting a sense of the struggle Jeremiah faced as he spoke an unpopular prophetic message from God, a relevant message for what justice looked like in the context of his time and place. I'll read now from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 1, and then verses 4 to 7. I'll read from the New Living Translation. Jeremiah wrote a letter from Jerusalem to the elders, priests, prophets, and all the people who had been exiled to Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar. The Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, sends this message to all the captives he has exiled to Babylon from Jerusalem. Build homes and plan to stay. Plant gardens, eat the food you produce, marry, have children. Then find spouses for them and have many grandchildren. Multiply. Do not dwindle away, and work for the peace and prosperity of Babylon. Pray to the Lord for that city where you are held captive. For if Babylon has peace, so will you. Bless these words, God, transforming us from within as we pursue peace and a home. Here, now. Amen.
feels to me this morning. So glad to be here with you. So glad. What I was saying. I'm so glad to know that you are my church family. I'm so glad that each of you can know that this is your church family. It feels to me this morning as if we gathered here for worship, and people all over this nation and this world, and for some time now, are in this place of joining the congregation of folks the prophet Jeremiah is speaking to. People exiled to a place that they didn't want to go. Doing their best to understand what peace and home can mean in this place. In this time, now. What does peace and home mean when home has moved from where we knew it to be, when everything is upended? Sometimes suddenly, in a moment. In Jeremiah's day, the people of Jerusalem were exiled to Babylon. And in this context, right, we just read the words, right? In that context, God is asking Jeremiah, right, we have help wanted signs everywhere today. Who's going to apply for Jeremiah's job? God asked Jeremiah to be his voice by speaking the following words, with a few more that I'll add, we'll paraphrase, if you will, from Pastor John. Not changing any words that are there, just adding a few to amplify their meaning for now. Jeremiah says, I know that this is not where you want to be, yet here is where you are. Build homes. Plan to stay. I know this isn't where you want to be, yet here is where you are. Plant gardens. Eat the food that you produce. I know. I know this isn't where you want to be. Yet here is where you are. Marry. Have children. Find spouses for them. Have grandchildren, multiply, do not dwindle away. I know that this is not where you want to be. Yet here is where you are. So work for peace and work for the prosperity of Babylon. Pray to the Lord for that city. Wow. All right. Pray to the Lord for that city where you are held captive. For if Babylon has peace, so will you. Jeremiah 29:5-7. The places we've been exiled to have different names than Babylon. Yet the story is much the same. And I'm just touching the surface with what I'm about to name. And you know that. When you wake up in Puerto Rico, in the wake of Hurricane Fiona, when you wake up in Florida around Devin Sharon, traveling there as we speak to their winter home in Cape Coral. When you are waking up in Florida in the wake of Hurricane Ian, you've been exiled to Babylon. You've moved to a place that you didn't want to move. Yet here you are. When you find yourself in Ukraine, after the Russian invasion, you've been exiled to Babylon. You've moved to a place that you didn't want to move. Yet here you are. When people are celebrating Columbus Day and you're part of the indigenous people of this land, you've been exiled to Babylon. You've moved to a place you didn't want to move. And here you are. And you've had your own places of Babylon. And some of you here this morning, very recently, and all of us here in this moment of Bill moving from one side of life to the next, we've all moved from a place we were to this place we've been exiled to, places you've been forced to move when you didn't want to, either physically moving or emotionally, spiritually moving as you process something particularly significant, such as the death of someone you hold especially dear. And yes, as I say, with that in mind, when you're part of this church family, and Bill Pedersen has died, and his brother Bob, and so many within this church family at this particular moment are struggling with cancer, and there have been so many recent deaths, you've been exiled to Babylon. You've moved to a place you didn't want to move, yet here you are. And here we are together. In Babylon, our ancestors were told to stay and to live and to move closer to God and to one another. Similarly, as we work out all the Babylon places that we currently find ourselves in, we too are encouraged to stay, to live, and to seek joy, and to move closer to God and one another as we process and do the work of bringing justice to issues of race and faith, the subject of our Tuesday evening adult study with people gathering locally and from Virginia and sometimes other places. And we process and bring healing to our political divide, and we process and bring healing to our shared grief. Through all of this, we bring peace where we are as we find an ever new sense. I've now lived here for 25 years, the longest I'd ever lived anywhere at one time before here was 13 and a half years. Wow, I'm like close to doubling that now. But even when you're someplace a long time, the definition of home, it shifts, it changes. So through all this, we bring peace where we are, and we find an ever new sense and understanding of home. At the top and bottom of PJ's place this week, I placed videos as I always do this week. I dug deep for just the right thing. Gorgeous visually and in sound this past week. Discovered this Canadian choral group that I called Mount Royal Cantori. At the top is a video dedicated to the people of Ukraine. This choral group singing Earth Song. Music and words by Frank Ticelli. Here are the words. By the way, if you haven't seen it, just do it. This dark, stormy hour, the wind, it stirs. The scorched earth cries out in vain, O war and power, you blind and you blur. The torn heart cries out in pain. But music and singing have been my refuge, and music and singing shall be my light, a light of song, shining strong, alleluia. Through darkness and pain and strife, I'll sing and I'll be and I'll live and I'll see peace, peace. In my heart and my mind this day is a couple I hold dear, a couple whom years ago each of their spouses died, finding themselves in a place that they didn't want to be. They wanted to be any place but that place, finding themselves in that place of exile and deep pain. And yet today, this very day, celebrating their first anniversary to one another, the joy on the other side of that pain. By the prayer in PJ's place, a video of the classic hymn, Be Still My Soul. It's number 488 in our hymnal. For years, some of you know this about me, some of you don't. For years, I've been leading worship at local assisted living communities, sometimes more, sometimes less, consistently, Christopher Heights and Webster. And for most of that time, I did that alone. I can't play guitar. I play piano poorly, well enough to bang out the notes. But then, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years ago, along came Bill, who was now retired, and he said, I want to join your On the Road tour, Pastor John. And so we started, and Bill was coming with me, and he's playing his guitar, and we're going up to Leominster when my mother was there, and that was the first place they started calling him Handsome Bill. I'm like, people don't even care if I'm showing up anymore. Just bring Handsome Bill. So Bill came and he started accompanying me on his guitar. And now things have moved again, and peace and home have redefined again. And I'm singing a cappella. Again, I want to share with you just the first and the last verse of this song. It just seems so appropriate for this time. And again, folks who sing better than I, you find them down by the prayer in PJ's place. Be still, my soul. For God is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, God faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best eternal friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, the hour will soon be here. When we shall be with God whom we adore. With disappointment gone, no grief nor fear, sorrow replaced with joy forevermore. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed, we shall meet at last. So may we be still. For out of grief and struggle, great hope and new life is always born. Some who heard Jeremiah speak words of peace and home while they were in a place of grief and exile wanted to kill him for voicing this message of God. Yet we have come to understand the value of this message. Jeremiah calls us to live actively engaged with the world around us, nurturing relationship, healing, peace and home with people we are with in the place we now are, bringing peace and home anew, new life where we are. When you hear me say we seek peace and a home, please respond where we are. Let us pray. God, forgive us our lack of gratitude for the people you give us to journey with, especially when those people are people seeking to be their best. Forgive us our lack of gratitude for the places you send us to journey to, especially when those places are places which help us show your love. We seek peace and a home where we are. Holy Spirit, calm our fears, quiet our complaining, ease our suffering, comfort our sorrows. We seek peace and a home where we are. Jesus, teach us to move for justice and for peace as you move. Teach us to rest for restoration and home as you rest. We seek peace and a home where we are. Amen. Well, at this time, I'm going to come and collect these plates, hand them to our ushers, who will hand them to you. Again, we are 100% self-supporting in every way. Please simply give as generously as this day you can.
Bill and I used to perform this song together, and I want to dedicate this to the memory of Bill Patterson. And you can find this on page 285 in the hymnal. Spirit.
Dearest God, ask your blessing upon all gifts laid on and around this altar, indeed throughout this sanctuary and throughout your world. Blessings, dearest God, in this moment upon each one as they have joined from wherever they are today in this time of worship in their own place of need or joy this day. Your blessing, dearest God, rest upon these flowers, rest upon all the meaning they contain, rest upon every gift of time or talent. And these are financial gifts, dearest God, given freely, watering the roots of this tree, which seeks to offer life within this church family, and as we seek to serve these local communities and the world, in Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to continue now before our closing hymn with a prayer I did not write this day, a prayer written by Thomas Merton. God, I have no idea where I am going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end, nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think that I am following your will does not mean that I am actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does, in fact, please you. And I hope I have that desire in all that I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me by the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore will I trust you always, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death. I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen. Well, let us sing together our closing hymn, number 52. There's a name I love to hear. Oh, how I love Jesus, number 52. Thank you so much. I'm going to share another brief announcement. because I've been forgetting so much that I wrote myself a note, and it seems especially important this morning. As some of you, most of you may now know, so many people through the years have taken their turn leading coffee hour, and my wife Sarah is currently that person. And so Sarah has said, please, and maybe especially this morning, join for coffee hour, right through those doors, down the hall, Penniman Parlor, time of refreshment and continuing conversation. And if you'd ever like to help with that in any way, see Sarah. And you, Theo, thank you for carrying this light of... Theo's like, what? Am I in trouble? No, I'm here to thank you. Thank you for carrying this light of Christ in and through our sanctuary and out those doors so that we might not only follow, but become light for a world in such desperate need. Dearest God, in this moment, it is so easy for us to see your face reflected through Theo's face. It's so easy for us, dearest God, to see your face reflected through the faces of Bill and Bob and Greg. And yet in this moment, dearest God, we ask that you would help us see your face reflected through the faces of all, especially those who challenge us the most. Bless us and keep us. Your face shine upon us. Be gracious to us and give to all your world that which we most desperately need. Let it begin within our own hearts and homes, wherever that currently is. Your love and your peace. Amen.